The Spurs had the 22nd best record in the league, the 10th best record in the West, and actually the 17th best net rating. Some positive regression potential for the Spurs next season, maybe? Well, that's not the topic of this video. The Spurs have 3 first round picks and 1 in the lottery, which almost never happens. So, who are they likely to select? Well, I've scoured the internet for mock drafts to gain information and selected a few players per pick I think have a chance to be selected by the team, and I'm gonna give you some info on them. So without any further dilly-dallying, let's get into it. Let's start with Dyson Daniels, who played with the G League Ignite team. I have a dream. And that dream is to see Dyson Daniels and DeJounte Murray play basketball together. Actually, I don't even want to see the offensive tape of that. I just want to see how teams try to deal with DeJounte Murray and Dyson Daniels defending on the perimeter. Throw Devin Vassell in there as well, and you've got the perimeter defensive trio of dreams. Seriously though, Daniels' perimeter defense is really good. He's a competitor and has the size and anticipation to be a real pest out there. He's also very switchable and can guard anyone from small guards to mid-sized wings. He's an artist in the pick and roll, and his general playmaking instincts are of a pretty high level. He also makes the right play a lot of the time and does the little things. The jumper is very iffy and he struggles scoring at the rim. If Chip England gets a hold of him, we could see his shot become respectable though, and maybe the finishing improves with more spacing in the NBA. The downside is a bit scary, but the upside could be one of the best role players in the league at his peak. Jalen Duren really impressed towards the end of his college career with Memphis. He was immense defensively and a force inside on the offensive end. While more of his shots further from the basket did start going in during that period, I'm still not convinced about that part of his game. What I am sure about is his rim running potential though. That would probably be the base level for him. The upside for me lies in his passing. He really flashed some great playmaking. A lot of it was on the move and when he was rolling to the basket. This could spice up the Spurs offense and give them more options out of the pick and roll. He's also only 18 and won't turn 19 till November, so you'd imagine there's still so much development ahead of him. Jakob Poeltl has one more year in his deal and might be a trade target at the deadline, so getting Duren in now and having him develop and acclimatize to the league would probably be a good idea. Now let's talk about Jeremy Sochan out of Baylor. Sochan is a high ceiling, low floor player. He's got good size and intensity, he's very smart and flashes some tasty traits. He's extremely versatile as a defender and can maybe guard positions 1 through 5 if he gains a little more muscle. His long arms and great anticipation make him a headache to have to deal with, and his awareness off the ball was great. He's also got some passing potential that I'm really interested in, and his ball handling showed some life as well. He also plays with a lot of heart and is a guy who leaves it all on the court, so I think he'll fit in well with the culture of the Spurs organization. The jumper is iffy and is not the most crafty at the basket. The reward if the Spurs can develop him right could be a monster on the wing who can defend his tail off and can be more than a bit part player in offense. Lastly, with their first pick in this draft, let's talk about Johnny Davis. If a few things break right for Davis, I could see him being a solid to even very good player for a long time. The shot is a concern for some, but it looks good, he shot it well from the line, and he was good in the mid-range. He's another guy who could benefit from Chip England's services. The lack of athleticism worries are a bit overblown in my opinion. He's not a plus athlete, but I don't think he's a bad athlete either. He's never really going to be a primary facilitator, but I do think there's some passing potential there. The physical tools on the defensive end are limited too, but he shows good heart and passion, and was still a pretty productive defender at college. The scoring package is where things get really interesting though. He's a sniper from the mid-range and is very crafty and smart with the way he gets his shots off. He could definitely give the Spurs some needed scoring oomph, and I think he'll be free to do that on a team with more than a few complementary pieces. The combo of him, Josh Primo, and DeJounte Murray would probably make up the main offensive options for the team going forward, and if everything falls into place, the Spurs could do much worse than that. Now let's talk about pick 20 and 25, which I'm gonna combine here because the guys they're looking at 20 will probably be available at 25. Let's start with Nikola Jovic out of Mega. The line of thinking that the Spurs draft a lot of foreign guys is true, but it's getting kind of boring now. And yes, I know that by speaking about it, I'm making it worse. Despite that though, I wouldn't be surprised if the Spurs ended up picking Jovic. He's a tall playmaker with shooting potential and is very creative as a passer in transition. He's also got good instincts off the ball on the offensive end. He isn't the most athletic though and lacks the shiftiness or change of pace that you look for in high level ball handlers. His defense also wasn't great, and that was a combination of a lack of size and strength as well as intensity. His scoring game as a whole is also pretty underdeveloped, and he's going to need to put in some work on that end, but the potential of being a pretty solid starter is there. Next, let's talk about Kendall Brown. Brown has fallen pretty far down a lot of people's draft boards, including mine. But it's worth remembering why he was so high in the first place. He projects as a long and strong 3-and-D wing who can cause havoc off the ball offensively. That's exactly what all NBA teams want. The truth is, his offense was really underwhelming. He was very shot shy and hesitant with the ball in his hands. The jumper didn't look smooth at all, and even the defense wasn't as good as advertised. The tools are still there though, and I back the Spurs' ability to get him to use them better. He will need time, but if the Spurs are patient and provide him with the right resources, I think he can still become some version of that high-end projection. Next, let's talk about Jake Laravia. Laravia is a personal favorite of mine, and I think I'm probably higher on him than most. He's an incredibly smart player on both ends. His skill set as a shooter should solidify his floor as a role player, and the upside lies in his ball handling and passing, where he showed good potential in his time at Wake Forest. A 20% assist rate and a positive assist to turnover ratio should not be scoffed at for a wing role player. Defensively, I do worry about him as a point of attack defender, but he's far better off the ball, and he's actually a real plus as a help defender, and when the defense is in rotation. The lack of athleticism is another negative, but outside of when he's guarding the ball, it doesn't really come back to bite him much. He should be a decent role player at worst, and a solid starter at best. Next up, let's talk about Marjan Beauchamp out of the G League Ignite team. Beauchamp is an amazing athlete with great physical tools that needs some work to improve his overall skill level. He is excellent in transition, crashes the boards hard, and shows great potential as an on-ball defender. His wingspan and lateral quickness are the building blocks of a lockdown primary defender. He's still a bit rougher on the edges though, especially when it comes to his awareness and instincts. His ball handling isn't too bad either. How he's going to contribute offensively in the half court though is a big question that will need to be answered. But as long as he reaches his defensive potential and the jumper comes around, he should be able to make it work with the offensive talent around him. Let's now talk about Walker Kessler out of Auburn. It seems like Spurs fans have come to really love and appreciate Jakob Poeltl in recent years. Well, Walker Kessler might be the Jakob Poeltl of this draft. He's a monster defender on the interior and put up some ridiculously high block numbers at Auburn. He struggled in the perimeter and will mostly be a drop defender. That really reduces his ceiling as a prospect. He should be a threat inside in the offensive end as well, and I like him as a role in the pick and roll. The Spurs wouldn't be reaching for the stars with this pick, but they might be securing a solid two-way big for the next few years. Lastly, let's talk about Bryce McGowan out of Nebraska. The Spurs could use some more of a scoring punch, especially from the forward spots, and Bryce McGowan could definitely provide that. He's a good creator off the bounce, and has a decent bag of tricks to get past defenders and get shots off. His ability to do that at his size will raise some eyebrows, and if his skills are harnessed, he could be a very productive player in the right context. He is quite skinny though, he wasn't the most willing passer, and the jumper is kind of iffy. The defense was also very underwhelming at times, and I don't see much upside on that end. He'd be an interesting flyer, and considering the structure of the Spurs roster, he might be worth a pick here.